21st Century Radio is sponsored by Hieronymus & Company. Now more of 21st Century Radio with your host, Dr. Zoe Hieronymus.
It's all about soul. It's all about faith and a deeper devotion. It's all about soul. 'Cause under love is a stronger emotion.
Welcome to 21st Century Radio. I'm Dr. Zohara Hieronymus. Laura Kortner is our executive producer, and Anita Brockington, our engineer. As our guest this hour, C.R. Lawn, points out in his January 29 article in Acres USA, one of our favorite magazines, Restoring Our Seed Commons, he shows recent mergers between Bayer Monsanto, ChemChina Syngenta, Dow and DuPont now make three companies who hold the planet's seed trade in their hands. We've talked about global monopolies for decades, relative to food supply and agriculture, and tonight we continue that discussion. In my opinion, based on past and recent history, none of these corporations are to be trusted to preserve our heirloom and natural seeds, nor the freedom of growing food by individuals, which likely most of us worldwide regard as a sovereign pursuit in this nation, in one's right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In knowing that seeds and seed exchange and preservation is critical to life, C.R. Lawn founded Fedco Seeds Cooperative in 1978 and served on its management team for 40 years until his 2018 retirement. As a member now of the board of Open Source Seed Initiative, CR joins us to highlight the challenges we face in this nation and worldwide and why it's so essential to preserve the seed rights for all people as the cornerstone of our global commons. Thank you for joining us, CR.
Well, pleasure to be here.
Well, you have the most magnificent name, CR Lawn, for somebody to care about seeds.
Yeah, actually, I didn't really work in lawn seeds, oddly enough. Worked mostly with vegetables, but it's one of those coincidences that happen where a person's name and their trade seem to coincide.
Exactly, which they used to. You know, when people would be given names from foreign countries, they'd be given it based on what their trade was. So talk to us a bit about your own background and your youth growing up. I mean, people don't come to these kinds of passions just out of nowhere.
Yeah, well, my parents, interestingly enough, moved to Vermont when I was just a wee baby, and they homesteaded in Vermont in the 1940s, around the same time as the Nearings, but they never actually met the Nearings, and they did some market gardening and other pursuits. My dad ended up being a high school teacher and then later on a community college teacher, but family always had gardens, so it was in my blood, really. And when I got into my 20s, I decided also that I wanted to homestead, and I bought a place in Maine, way in the back 40, in a very rural part of Maine, in cold zone 4A, and I started growing a big garden and did small scale marketing for a little while, and then got involved with the food cooperative movement. And as an outgrowth of the food cooperative movement, one year I made an offer to the Maine Federation of Cooperatives, which no longer exists now, but they were sort of an umbrella organization for Maine co-ops and the Back to Landers in Maine. There was a whole movement around the late 60s and the 1970s that I was a part of, and they formed a lot of co-ops, so this Federation of Co-ops kind of was their governing body. And one year I went to work for the Federation of Co-ops on special projects and decided to coordinate a statewide garden seed order, and that became Fedco Seeds. Mm-hmm. It just took off like a rocket, and soon it swallowed up all my other special projects, and I had started what was going to be my lifetime work, although I certainly never expected it at the time.
Yeah, no, and I went online to look at Fedco Seeds Cooperative, and it's what a wonderful service you offer of so many different types of foods that you won't even see in the grocery store, but you can grow in your backyard. So having spent your lifetime in making sure that people can get good food and share the food they grow and that consumers know where their food comes from and how it's grown and what it's grown with, you're now part of what I introduced as the Open Seed Source Seed Initiative. So share with us what this is and why it's so important.
What this is basically is the mission is to try to ensure fair and open access to plant genetic resources worldwide. It is a worldwide organization. There are other similar initiatives in other countries, several in Europe. The European seed laws are somewhat different from ours, so it requires different approaches. But basically what we're trying to do is to promote the sharing rather than the restricting of the access to plants and plant germplasm, germplasm really being a fancy word for plant variety or any of the genetic material that can go into making up such a variety. And we're trying to promote sharing in a world that has kind of gone the other way. What you've seen, you mentioned at the outset, the concentration of the seed industry. There's now only four huge multinational corporations that control more than 60% of the seed industry. The three mergers that you mentioned plus BASF became sort of the fourth most important company due to the antitrust concerns in the first three majors. Bayer was forced to sell a portion of its seed business to BASF. But those are the four, and there are also a number of other large corporations involved in the seed trade. But only a few corporations dominate the seed trade, and coincidental to the corporate domination of the seed trade has been a regime of increasing intellectual property restrictions. So that these days, when you go to a seed catalog and you pick out a seed variety that you want, there is a fairly good chance that you're not really buying those seeds. All you're really doing is renting them for a one-time use.
Explain, we're going to step back now, because I don't know how many people, particularly a backyard gardener, would know that an intellectual property right is interfering with our ability to plant, to grow, to consume. Why? How can intellectual property rights be used and applied to something no human has made, but that nature provides, or God, or creator, or however you want to put it, and then claim the right to it?
Well, that's a very good question. The reason that they can is that court rulings have allowed them to do so. Also, legislation has allowed them to do so. And in fact, until the last 200 years, there really weren't seed companies, and it was more recently than that corporations got involved. You don't see these intellectual property rights coming along really until, in the U.S., 1970 was the first time there was any serious legislation creating intellectual property rights.
Right, but what I don't never understand about, and I haven't really studied this area of the backdrop meaning to intellectual, there's nothing intellectual about picking a dandelion out of the field and saying, my company's going to patent this and nobody else can take this dandelion and make anything with it. Is that kind of what's going on?
It's close. It's a little bit more complex.
All right.
Than
give us the complex side so I can get educated too. How do these major global corporations, now controlling 60% of the seed bank on this planet, which is frightening in itself, use intellectual property rights to prevent the consumer, the grower, the farmer, the distributor of seed from actually being free to use seed how they see fit?
Well, they do have to make some kind of change to create a variety that would be patented. They are supposed to use some form of original art.
Okay.
However, which means that they can't just go out and patent your dandelion without without doing some kind of breeding work or changing. But what they can do is they can use traits that actually do occur in nature, and they can make crosses, they can use genetic engineering, and they can create a variety that's slightly different, and they can patent it if they so choose. Or they can put some other form of restrictions. There's a number of different ways the intellectual property restrictions show up, patents being the broadest one. But
right.
But there's also something called the Plant Variety Protection Act, which allows a limited form of patenting, but does allow people to save gardeners, home gardeners. Anybody actually can save those seeds, but they can't sell or give them away, and breeders can use those. But since the Supreme Court has ruled that plant varieties can now be utility patented, utility patents are very broad, and they can cover more than just even a specific variety. They can cover traits in a variety. They can cover usages in a variety. And in many cases, they have been applied to cover traits that do occur in nature. And one of the problems here is that the patent office is overwhelmed with applications, and they haven't really applied as strict discrimination in deciding what can be patented and what can't as they might have done. And it's possible that, I mean, we have talked about trying to put some energy into perhaps we'd have to get involved with patent law and have a lawyer, you know, to actually try to petition or work with people in the patent office to take a more literal interpretation of what it means to have some kind of original art. And the other thing is it has to have social utility be patented.
Fascinating. So in terms of what the Open Source Seed Initiative, which is you're now on the board and it's an important global organization of individuals, OSSI, and you can find that online at www.osseeds.org. You have four seed freedoms you're trying to protect, and we'll start with one. One is to save and grow seed for replanting or any other purpose. And now to the average person who does a plant garden or maybe a farmer in the audience, farmers know a little bit more about this because they've already faced restrictions. But the average person who goes and buys their cucumbers and their lettuce and their beans to plant in their garden, you all point out that this is being interfered with. A bit at a time, even though I remember reading when they were trying to outlaw, in some state they successfully outlawed the seed library, which is where people would bring their seeds left over from their gardens, and you could take them and bring in yours, and people would trade. Is this being interfered with?
There have been a couple of cases where seed libraries were interfered with. I think that the rationale being that if seeds are exchanged or sold, many states and the federal government as well has a minimum germination requirements, et cetera, to ensure that, you know, a good product is being sold. The libraries, technically, their exchanges, and probably in most cases, the participants aren't doing those kinds of tests. So they closed them on a pretty narrow technicality, and I haven't heard of too many cases of that happening. There were one or two. But in the case of the restriction on saving seeds, typically the intellectual property restriction will read something to the effect that you may only plant the crop for a one-time use, and you may not propagate any further generations from that crop. So in other words, you plant your sweet corn seed and you harvest the sweet corn, but if you then go ahead and let those ears dry and save the seeds and replant those seeds, you are technically violating that patent.
And what kind of enforcement follows when somebody, let's say a farmer in the audience, he grew a bunch of sunflowers and it had restrictions on it, but he saved the sun or she saved the sunflower seeds and sold them again the next year. What happens?
Well, the reality is that nothing is very likely to happen. It's kind of a curious situation. It's not a very transparent situation.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a home gardener or a small farmer, and you go ahead and do this, the large companies aren't going to care. They, first of all, they won't know about it, and second of all, they're not going to care. And third of all, if they did try to go after small-time people, they'd get a very bad press. They get a bad reputation.
All right, so next year when I plant my my pea pod seeds that I saved, my snow peas, no one's going to come into my garden. I remember there was a time period people were really terrified of local policing of backyard gardens. But this would affect a larger grower who has always had a habit of growing extra crop, saving the seed, and selling it in his, you know, yard stand or something. That would no
it
longer
could.
Be allowed.
It could, and mm-hmm. That grower would be violating the restriction, and you know the large corporations would be interested if it was a large enough operation. They might be anyway, and there's a precedent there, and of course that was infamous Monsanto going after farmers who did just that. Basically, there were contractual or bag tag restrictions on those seeds, and those farmers who allegedly planted them anyway got into trouble. Monsanto had a team of people going out trying to enforce those restrictions, and in many cases the farmers ended up didn't end up in court. Some did, a few did, but mostly they ended up signing some form of consent agreement by which they agreed to reimburse Monsanto for some undisclosed sum, and usually those kinds of agreements had a no disclosure clause, so they couldn't talk about.
Mm-hmm. I remember covering a couple cases. We have to take a break, and we'll come back to some of the other things OSSI is working and dedicated to maintain fair and open access to plant genetic resources for the future. But I remember covering a few cases where there were organic farmers and the GMO seed contaminated their fields, and Monsanto came after them saying they had stolen their patented copyrighted seeds, when in fact no organic farmer wants anything to do with GMO because it's not good for anybody or anything, at least in my opinion and many other scientists. We'll be right back. Our guest is C.R. Lawn, and I do want to remind you all, acresusa.com is where to go, where this article is, Restoring Our Seed Commons, and they also have a website where Acres USA shows some of their articles. It's called ecofarmingdaily.com, and you can find this article there as well by C.R. Lawn. The organization we're talking about, however, is www.osseeds.org.
Hi, my name is Courtney White. I am an author and an activist and a co-founder of the Kivira Coalition, which is a nonprofit based in Santa Fe that brings ranchers and farmers and conservationists together. I have written a number of books on carbon and food and climate. You can learn more about my writing and work at my website, which is jcourtneywhite.com. And you are listening to 21st Century Radio with Zohara Hieronymus. Thank you very much.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio, another person I found through our wonderful friends at Acres USA. And don't forget to be a subscriber to their magazine. You can also read their contributions from their editors at ecofarmingdaily.com, acresusa.com. And our guest that I found in this month's issue, C.R. Lawn. He authored an article entitled Restoring Our Seed Commons. And he is on the board of the Open Source Seed Initiative, OSSI, whom are dedicated to maintaining fair and open access to plant genetic resources for the future. So you all have these four freedoms that the Open Source Seed Initiative, CR, are trying to protect. We mentioned one, the freedom to save and grow seed for replanting or for any other purpose. The second one is the freedom to share, trade, and sell seed to others. I mean, most people would think, well, can't anybody do that?
Well, maybe not. It depends on the variety. And my biggest concern is that the whole system is not transparent. If you read a seed catalog, or, you know, if you're buying seed from a store rack, you're not going to know if you're getting a restricted variety or not. The better seed catalogs will tell you which seeds are patented, and they'll list the plant variety protected varieties. But there are a couple other forms of intellectual property rights that don't get transmitted very easily. One of the most common one is bag tags. And in order to understand these, you need to look at the whole system, which is basically you've got these very large wholesalers. For the most part, they're large corporations. And then you have the seed sellers that you might be familiar with as a gardener or a farmer. Those are some of those seed sellers do produce some of their own seed, but in many cases they're primarily buying from the wholesalers.
Right.
Okay, so the wholesaler will have what's called a bag tag. It's literally they put an intellectual property restriction either in their contract to the seed retailer or on the bag of seeds that the seed retailer opens and then repacks so that you, the end user, will get a packet of seed that came out of that bag. But you'll never get to see the bag tag. You'll never get to see the contract between the retailer and the wholesaler. And so as an end user, unless your retailer tells you, you're not going to know that you purchased anything that has any restrictions on it. And that's what bothers me the most about the whole system.
Why? I mean, I can see in the long run the why, but in the short run, and of course I'm always looking down road, I'm asking kind of just out of curiosity, because if they don't enforce it, let's say I go to a retail store and I buy a particular kind of sweet corn seed and I plant it and then later find out that, oh my gosh, that was actually a restricted seed, what difference will it make to me as the gardener or the farmer?
As a gardener, it probably never will.
And
unless you're a big farmer, it probably never will.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of these situations where it's not likely to be enforced, but Monsanto did enforce these kinds of agreements, and they could conceivably be enforced at some point in the future.
Yes.
especially if the society continues to evolve in the directions where it has. I mean, what Monsanto did would have been unthinkable a generation or two previously.
Absolutely true. Absolutely
true. That's one of my concerns.
So in other words, to just try to understand this a little better myself, is what's happening is they're putting in place the mechanisms for enforcement of control, even if right now it's not being enforced at the local small retail end. But the instruments of, let's just call it what it is, complete fascism, where the government works with corporations to control a market, in this case our food and our seed and our rights to grow our own food. The implementation, I mean, the instruments exist to limit us severely in the future, even if right now that's not the case. Now, India, I know, has had a big fight against Monsanto and the GMO seed. So there are nations. Ours is the least vigorous other than the citizenry. Europe has virtually outlawed GMO, but these corporations are very interested in getting their genetic seed as our food worldwide. Is that not fair to say?
Oh, yeah, they are, and they got a real stronghold in the United States way back in the Reagan administration, and in fact, every administration right on through has protected these corporations. Even the Obama administration, which made a big show of having hearings about market concentration, but then didn't follow up or do anything about it. I think you stated really well that the mechanisms are in place, mm-hmm. and though they're not now being enforced, there's a possibility down the road that they could be. And
oh well, we can
the other,
see
the other problem
yeah.
here with looking at us, you know, us farmers and gardeners as the third party users is what is, you know,
mm-hmm.
is that the problem there is that the wholesalers are not clear, even with to the seed companies, about whether or not they intend to have these restrictions enforced to third-party users.
Mm-hmm.
What I did is, while I was still at Fedco, I went through our catalog listings and identified about 120 out of the over 1,000 varieties that Fedco offered that had these restrictions. And then at the suggestion of another staff person, I took it a step further and actually queried some of the wholesalers, well, do you mean for these restrictions to apply to the end users?
Mm-hmm.
And I got a very mixed set of responses. Some of the wholesalers did, some of the wholesalers didn't, and some of them said, well, if it's a really large user, like another seed company or a big farmer, the restrictions apply, but we are not worried about home gardeners or small farmers.
But so, you and I both know, and I think anybody who is in the organic, biodynamic, permaculture, the healthy agriculture movement is rightly terrified. I am. I mean, I'll just say of myself, I am deeply disturbed about losing our seed bank in this planet and it being under the control of government. And that is very possible looking at the direction that this is going. So an organization like the Open Source Seed Initiative jumps out in front and says, oh no, we're going to try to protect these freedoms to save and grow seed, for replanting, to share, trade, and sell. The third one, the freedom to trial and study seeds and to share and publish information about them. I mean, Thomas Jefferson couldn't have grown the foods he did and improve on foods. I mean, there are wonderful gardeners worldwide who improve on varieties through their work of grafting, etc.
Yes, and the important thing about Aussie is that we're looking forward. What we're trying to do is to get new varieties into circulation that are open source. And the way we do that is through the Aussie Pledge. What we do is we encourage breeders to pledge their seeds to open source.
What does that mean for somebody who doesn't know?
Yeah,
open source?
Okay, so let's take a typical arrangement that what we're really fighting against here and is a form of copyright where, you know, whoever created the variety in effect patents or copyrights it and then has full rights to it, and you can't use it without their permission. What the Aussie Pledge is derived from open source software, and it basically turns the copyright on its head using a mechanism called copyleft. And if I read you the...
Is that really what it's called? I've never heard
really
that expression.
It's really called copyleft.
That's
yeah.
fantastic.
I couldn't have invented this. So if I read you the pledge, you'll understand what copyleft is.
All right.
Pledge reads, you have the freedom to use these Aussie Pledge seeds in any way you choose. In return, you pledge not to restrict others' use of these seeds or their derivatives by patents or any other means, and to include this pledge with any transfer of these seeds and their derivatives.
So Aussie, I mean, one of the things you all are doing is you're like a seed savers cooperative because you have 451 varieties, right, from 38 participating breeders offered by 61 seed company partners. So
okay,
you all have taken the pledge.
My latest figures are even a little higher. We have 461 varieties, and yes, 38 breeders and now 62 seed company partners.
Wonderful.
And how we get these numbers is, let's say we got a plant breeder out there, and this could be a freelance plant breeder who, or a plant breeder that's affiliated with a seed company or not, or it could be a university plant breeder.
Right.
And all they need to do is they have a variety that they want to Aussie pledge. Aussie has a variety review committee. They look over the application and make sure that it qualifies, and then Aussie pledges it, and that breeder then is one of our cooperating breeders. Likewise with the seed companies. The seed companies, if they join Aussie as a partner, all they have to do is offer at least one Aussie pledge variety. And of those 62 seed company partners, some offer scores of varieties, others offer only a handful, but the seed companies who are really supportive of Aussie often cases are going out of their way. They're looking, being very proactive to try to get more of these varieties in their catalog. I know at Fedco it was, you know, when we were selecting, if something was Aussie pledged, then, you know, it got a leg up in being selected when I was there.
So of these 38 breeders, 62 seed companies, and 461 pledged varieties, those are protected from companies like Monsanto or ChemChina, Syngenta, or DowDuPont, or BASF, from taking those and doing anything to them or restricting them because you all have them?
Right. Actually, Monsanto can breed with them because it is open source, but they have to agree to
keep it
follow
that way.
The pledge. So, so they couldn't put any intellectual property restrictions on them if they did. So, of course, to them, that's like a poison pill.
Right, so there'd be
they
no reason
they,
for
they
them.
They wouldn't be interested in anything like that. In fact,
are there laws preventing open source? Is that the direction this is all headed?
No, there aren't. There are no laws preventing open source.
Thank God for that.
But there, you know, it can be very challenging though for university plant breeders to get a variety into open source, because in many cases the universities now mostly have intellectual property organizations that are the ones who distribute these seeds, and there was a whole series of laws passed during the Reagan administration, particularly the Bayh-Dole Amendment, which actually gave universities profit centers in developing businesses around their plant breeding.
And so
they could sell them. So what we had there was an evolution. The traditional land-grant varieties in the golden age of classical plant breeding, which was pretty much from the late 1800s to about 1960, the theory was that since they were funded by taxpayer money, any of their varieties that came out of their programs would be out in the public domain. And in fact, until 1924, the U.S. Department of Agriculture had a program where it distributed many of these seeds to farmers for free because they were trying to further the goals of plant variety improvement.
Right.
And that only got stopped by the American Seed Trade Association lobbying, the American Seed Trade Association, of course, being the trade group of the seed companies that had mostly started up, you know, after 1850 and grew much stronger in the 1900s.
It's extraordinary history. We do have to take a break. When we come back, we'll go to the Fourth Freedom. If you're just joining us, our guest is C.R. Lawn. He is a member of the board of the Open Source Seed Initiative, OSSI, and they are dedicated to maintaining fair and open access to plant genetic resources for our future. You can learn more about their work. If you're a grower or a breeder, you might want to join www.osseeds.org.
Hello, my name is Ranelle Mitchell-Hawkins, 4-H educator for University of Maryland Extension. You can learn more about our programs and youth development at www.extension.umd.edu. You are listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zohara Hieronymus.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. If you're just joining us, C.R. Lawn is our guest. He is a board member of the Open Source Seed Initiative, OSSI, their website www.osseeds.org. I learned about them from our good friends at Acres USA, who are online as well. And they have now a wonderful website I didn't know about till recently, ecofarmingdaily.com, where their editors put together some of the choices of their magazine articles. So you can learn all about it. We are discussing the loss of freedom of use of seeds that is encroaching on us a little bit at a time worldwide, and what some are doing to make sure that not only is there clarity on intellectual property rights, which is what the big corporations use to prevent people from doing what they want with seed, but to be sure that those who want to create new products and improve on the food quality we have can do so. So the fourth freedom, CR, was the freedom to select or to adapt seeds, to make crosses, or to use them to breed new lines and varieties.
Yes, yes. And of course, that's the one that's nearest and dearest to farmers who want to get into plant breeding, or at least into selecting to improve varieties. In fact, right in Maryland, there's a prime example of such a farmer, Brett Groskow, Even Star Farm in southern Maryland, has been doing this for years and actually developed winter hardy greens for his restaurant trade in D.C.
How interesting.
And this became like a, really the cornerstone of a successful farming.
How fascinating.
And I know other growers who do this as well. I know another one person in Connecticut, Brian O'Hara, who works and improves varieties. And actually, a survey of growers of the Organic Seed Alliance indicated that they are very interested in doing seed work. So this is particularly near and dear to organic farmers who probably on the whole are more interested in working with seeds, which of course was the age-old thing that farmers did for hundreds and thousands of years. Most of our great varieties really came from that, and seed companies got into the act rather late in the day.
Mm-hmm. It's so interesting. Last year, I planted an all heirloom garden of anything that was heirloom from the 1800s.
Oh, wow. That's really cool.
It was magnificent. I have to tell you, I didn't plant as many varieties of anything, but the lettuces and the beans and the tomatoes are so superlative. They're hardier, they're bigger, they resist damages. It's an extraordinary thing to be able to still get them. And so people like me are very concerned that everybody in the listening audience and generations down line have the freedom to plant what they want to plant, when they want to plant it, use it, eat it, share it, and save seed. What are other nations doing? Like I mentioned earlier, and I can't remember the woman's name who started such a beautiful effort in India to save their heirloom seeds.
Oh, Vandana Shiva.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean,
a whole organization that's doing that kind of work.
Well, there's an awareness. What I'm trying to point to is there is an awareness worldwide that these megalithic corporations that control 60% of the seed bank right now is a frightening development for planetary survival.
Yeah, one of our seed company partners is in Australia and has developed this amazing dwarf heirloom project for tomatoes, the idea being to breed for tomatoes for container gardening.
Uh-huh.
And so I've tried at least one of these varieties, and it was pretty darn good. The interesting thing is that, for the most part, tomatoes that have been dwarfed don't have the flavor of ones that haven't, because mm-hmm. a lot of the complexity of flavor comes from more photosynthesis. But she, and this is worldwide, she's got partners working on this all over the world. She's actually been able to create some varieties that are suitable for containers that really do have that classic tomato flavor. So I think this is something that could become, you know, they could be very popular in a few more years, I think.
So,
an example of the kinds of projects that can be done.
Yeah, and maybe one time I should have a program just on how farmers make better plants. I mean, somebody tried to tell me, oh, there was always genetic engineering. And I said, no, I don't think grafting is the same thing as genetic engineering.
No, actually, classical plant breeding is very different from genetic.
Exactly, and that's what I said to this person who was trying to trip me up when I was telling them that GMO seed is going to destroy the world. Animals won't eat it. It makes people sick. If there's nothing healthy about it, it's a non-living substance. And when you douse it, you get nothing. It's a dead thing. The food is dead.
It's an interesting thing. This is a language problem here that we unfortunately let them get away with.
Yeah.
They called it genetically modified organisms. Well, classical plant breeding genetically modifies organisms. That's not the issue here. The issue is that these are not modified in the classic way. They're engineered.
Exactly. It's totally separate.
And we should have insisted that we stick to that term, genetic engineering, or even transgenics, which is when you're crossing a species barrier,
exactly.
which plants rarely can do
on their own
without human intervention.
Exactly. The only one I wondered sometimes myself if an alien didn't make the carnivorous plants. And then dropped it here on Earth to see how we'd handle it. So what haven't we touched on that will help our listeners better understand? What can they do? Okay, let's say, you know, the catalogs are coming out. I can't believe it's already seed picking time for me. I start planting my garden in January every year. So what can someone in the audience who plants a backyard garden, or we have a lot of farmers in Maryland or farming associations, what can farmers do to make sure that this kind of effort to protect our rights continues?
Well, one way is to go on to the OSSI website and to make a list of those seed company partners who interest you, maybe those from your area or uh-huh. ones you've heard of or just that you're intrigued by, and buy from them.
I see.
And OSSI encourages the partners to indicate, you know, as clearly as possible on their websites and in the catalog, preferably by using OSSI's logo to identify those varieties so people can find them and buy them. OSSI is not a seed company itself. We're trying to help our seed company partners, and in a way, you could look at this as a kind of a label analogous to fair trade coffee or mm-hmm. organically grown seeds or you know, it's basically an ethical label.
Lovely.
And that would be the other thing if you could do is to just select open pollinated seeds rather than hybrids if you want to take a quicker and maybe lazier approach. If chances are there are some open pollinated varieties with intellectual property restrictions, but the chances are much less.
And will it say open pollinated on a seed packet?
The better seed companies will identify it as open pollinated. It might not, but the better seed companies do. And the thing about open pollinated seeds, too, is that if you want to save those seeds, they will come true to type in the next generation, provided you follow certain rules of seed saving. Namely, if you've got a crop that crosses readily and you want to plant more than one variety, you have to isolate those two varieties by pretty far distance.
Or, I mean, there was a time that I was very interested in a seed bank in Maryland. You can't do everything you think of in the world. Thank God there are people like you who do things I think of. But it has occurred to me, like I think anybody who grows their own food, how precious seed is. And without it, we won't have food. And so I like the way you've raised this as sort of, to me, this is the cornerstone of the commons. And
yes.
Without it, we're really in trouble on this planet, and worse trouble than we can imagine. If you don't have the right to grow your own food, what do you have?
Right, and I would say start by becoming a seed saver. It's pretty, certain seeds are really easy to save. Beans may be the easiest of all, and you just let the beans in the pods dry, and there you go. And beans don't cross very readily, so if you just keep your varieties 10 or 20 feet apart, that should be most of the time good enough to be able to do that. You might not get 100% purity, but you get close. Tomato seeds are pretty easy to save as well. And again, those don't readily cross. Some of the heirlooms cross more readily than the others. But even so, if you put a little distance between your varieties, you won't get much crossing there either.
We'll have to do that on the next show. We do have to say goodnight. I want to thank you, CR, for all the work you've done your entire lifetime and continue to do to make sure that future generations will have healthy, wholesome food and rights. Follow up with OSSI at osseeds.org. You can also go to acresusa.com, Echo Farming Daily. But again, buy from the seed growers at osseeds.org.
Stay connected with stimulating talk and breaking news on Talk Radio 680 WCBM, Baltimore, and WCBM.com.